welcome to part two of our tutorial on painting a Putrid Blightking. Now, so far we've done all the larger areas on the miniature, and now we're going to do all the remaining details. So this is going to cover things like the horns, the metallics, on which we're going to do a really cool poisonous effect, and all the open wounds and sores as well, and even the little nurgling in his belly. Now, this part's going to be loads of fun, so let's get painting. The first detail I'm going to concentrate on will be the bone. Now, I've often shown you how to paint bone before in these tutorials, but this time I want to go for something just a little bit different because I want it to look yellowed and rotten and horrible. Now, the first colour you need for this is Zandri dust, and I'm going to apply it using a standard brush. And for this first stage, you're looking at getting as even a base coat as you can. So then you want to paint down once again with a little bit of water, making sure I don't have too much paint on my brush. And then I'm just going to start painting it onto the horns around here. Now, when you're base coating this on, just try and leave a little bit of the darker black just showing just between the green of the armour and where the yellower bone starts. So just around there, just to help define the two details. And also, you may find you need to apply more than one coat of this colour to get an even coat. That's absolutely fine. Remember, it's always best to apply multiple thin coats rather than one thick coat. And there we go, the base coat is now done. Now, sometimes in this Putrid Blightking kit, you'll find that the horns have little ridges towards the base of them. And if they do, you just need to pick those out now. Now for this, you need a sharpety bone and a fine detail brush. And you just need to use your palette to get as fine a tip on your brush as you can. So thin your paint down a little bit and just twist it again just to bring the bristles to a nice point. And what you're looking to do is just paint a thin line along the most pronounced of these ridges. So on this hole on the back here, for example, I'm just gonna paint just a few lines just running down the back just to pick out those areas of detail. You don't need very much, just towards the base of the horn, certainly no more than halfway up. So with that highlight done, we're now ready to move on to the next step, which is to darken down the horn towards the tip. Now the idea here is to get further and further towards a dark brown right to the very end of the horn. And the first colour you need to do this is Reichland Flesh Shade, but I don't want this colour to be too strong, so I'm going to dilute it with some Lamia Medium. I'm going for a 1-to-1 mix here. So I'm going to use a standard brush to make my mix on my palette. So get a good amount of the Reichland Flesh Shade. And remember to be careful that you don't contaminate your medium with any colour. So wash your brush before you get any of it out of the pot. And mix them together. So you're looking for your mix to be looking kind of like that. Now you don't want to be applying too much of this at once. So make sure you don't have a whole lot on your brush. And you're looking to paint this on each horn around about halfway down from the tip. So it's going to be quite subtle. I'm going to be going down to around about there. Now, what you should do is paint this all the way around the whole horn. I'll just show you on this side just to show you what I'm doing. When you're down to about halfway, use your tissue just to get rid of the excess of the mix off your brush, and then use what you've got left just to bring down this mix towards the base of the horn, down to about there. So you're going about 3/4 of the way down. And you see, doing this, I get a very smooth blend from the light colour down here, and it just gradually gets darker towards the tip. So you just need to do this now on each of the horns. When that mix is completely dry, the next stage is to add another shade to it. Now this time I'm going to be using Reichland Flesh Shade again, but I'm not going to dilute it with Lamia Medium this time. I'm just going to keep the pure colour. So as before, I'm just going to make sure I've got some on my brush, still a standard brush, but not too much. So use your tissue to get rid of the excess. Then when you're ready, you're just looking to paint this on the horn just a bit further towards the tip. So on this one I was doing last time, I'm going to be adding a bit more, just about halfway down or so. Notice the direction I'm painting it, kind of in lines like this. And that gives a nice smooth transition then. See, it's just gradually getting darker. So what I'm going to do now is just carry on building this up on all the horns. Once that coat's dry, apply another of Reichland Flesh Shade, and again, just a little bit further up towards the tip. Apply it in the same way, still with not much on the brush, just to continue darkening down the tip of the horn just further. Now that shade's dry, you can see the effects really coming through. There's not much more left to do to finish it off. The next colour to use is Agrax Earthshade, and this is, well, really carrying on the same method, really. Just need to get some, and still using a standard brush here. And just make sure that whilst you've got some loaded on your brush, you really don't have too much. So just use your tissue to get rid of the excess. And, well, you're just looking to paint this even further towards the tip of the horn. So I'm going down about a fifth of the way now, so just towards the tip, like that. And once that's dry, the final step is just one more coat of Agrax Earthshade, this time though, just on the very tip. Again, not much at all, but once you've done that, the horns are finished. And there we go, the bone is now finished. And well, I really like using this technique because it looks really good. And as you've seen, it's actually pretty easy to do as well. So now that that's finished, the next stage I'm gonna paint is the silver, and I want this to look kind of corroded and poisonous. So I'm gonna be using similar techniques to do it. The first stage though is to apply a base coat. So I'm gonna be using lead belcher for this, and I'm going to apply it using my standard brush. So for this first step, you're just looking to get as even a base coat as you can. So once you've got your paint ready, just looking to apply this over all of the sword blade and, well, whatever blade you happen to be doing, whether it's an axe or a pick or whatever. With the base coat done, we're now ready to apply the first shade onto the metal. And for this, I'm going to be using Seraphim Sepia. And I'm going to be mixing it with Lamia Medium because, well, like when we were doing the horns earlier, I don't want the first colour to be too strong. So you just need to use your palette to get your mix together. And, well, remember, be careful not to contaminate your medium with any colour. So I just wash my brush before I get any. And you're looking for a one-to-one mix here. So once you've got your mix sorted on your palette, you're just looking to apply this over all of the blade, except for close to the tip. So I'm going to be painting this over most of it. So you can see I'm putting on a fair amount there, but as I'm getting close to the top, I'm just going to take a moment just to get rid of the excess off my brush, and then just draw that shade up to the tip. So this first coat will be quite subtle, but as you've seen with the horn, we're going to build up on top of this. Once the first coat's completely dry, apply a second on most of the blade this time, just going up about 3/4 of the way. And this is still the one-to-one mix of Seraphim Sepia and Lamia Medium, just like before. Also notice I'm not applying a whole lot at once. And with that mix now being dry, we've got a really horrible sickly yellow running down the blade. Now the next thing is to darken it down even more towards the base of the sword. And for this, I'm going to be using Agrax Earthshade and still applying it with my standard brush using, well, the same technique we've been using for a while now. So once again, just make sure you don't have too much of the shade on your brush. Use some tissue just to get rid of the excess. And this time you're going to be painting this for about 1/3 of the way up the blade. So just down here, then up to about there. And once that coat's dry, just add a second of Agrax Earthshade just at the very base of the sword, just down there. And once you've done that, you just need to switch over to your fine detail brush and paint a small amount of Agrax Earthshade just into these little dips running across the sword blade, just to mark these parts out. And there we go. Now the shade is dried, you can see we've got a really horrible looking effect on the sword. You wouldn't want to go and touch that, would you? Now all that remains to be done is an edge highlight going around the blade. And for this, I'm going to be using Iron Breaker. So I'm going to use my fine detail brush to apply this. And well, you just need to use your palette to get that really nice tip on your brush. So I'm just thinning the paint down with a little bit of water, a little bit more than that, I think. And use your palette just to bring your bristles to a nice tip. And what you're looking to do here then is go around the edge of all the sword and well, down the middle as well. So you can use your brush at an angle on these edges here, and you can just run your brush like that, and this way you see you get a nice neat straight line very quickly. When it comes to the middle of the sword, well, that's when you need to steady hand. So just keep your model as steady as possible and then just run a line going down the middle of the blade like that. Now there are all these little holes and things down the sword as well, so you do need to go around those too. Once you've done that, the sword blade will be finished. And with the edge highlight done, the sword is finished. And we can now move on to the other metallic colour, which is going to be bronze. Now for this, you need 4 different colours. We're going to start out with a base coat of Balthazar Gold. Then I'm going to shade over these areas using Agrax Earthshade. After that, I'm going to apply an edge highlight using Sycorax Bronze. Then finally, I'm going to add a bit of Nylac Oxide just for a bit of verdigris. So to start out with Balthazar Gold, I've got 2 brushes. I've got my standard and my detail. So, well, again, I can switch depending on what size and area I'm painting. And for this first step, you're just looking to get a really even base coat over all the parts that you want to be bronze. Now these parts will vary quite drastically depending on how you've decided to build your Blightkings. So just take your time working around the miniature, picking these parts out. And well, once you're done, we can add some shape to them. Next, I'm going to apply a shade of Agrax Earthshade over all the bronze areas that I've just base coated. Now whilst you're doing this, just be careful that you don't put on too much so that the shade doesn't start running and dripping onto all the other areas that you've already painted. When the shade's completely dry, use your fine detail brush to apply an edge highlight of Sycorax Bronze all around the edges of all the bronze parts. And also, don't forget to do all the little pitted circles in the metal as well. And finally, use your fine detail brush just to paint in a small amount of Nylac Oxide into some of the deepest recesses on the bronze. This gives it a nice weathered verdigris look. Now don't go crazy when you're doing this, but what you can do as well is paint some of this onto the sword blade too, and doing so is a really great way to tie both of these metallic areas together. With the Nylac Oxide applied, you can see we've now got a really nice weathered and worn appearance to the bronze, which is, of course, perfect for Nurgle. And with that done, we can now move on to the part that I've been looking forward to the most, and that's to add all the open wounds and sores and all that kind of stuff. Now, for a lot of this, I'm going to be using shades in the same kind of way that I was doing the horns and the weapon earlier. And when you're doing this part, I really recommend that you apply the colours in moderation, because you can always add more later on if you want to. Now, the first one I'm going to do is with Druki Violet and Lamia Medium. I'm going to do a one-to-one mix for this. And this is to create kind of bruises on the miniature. So you just need to get your mix ready on your palette, and I'm using a detail brush to apply this. So get the same amount of Lamia Medium. Just mix that together. Now you want to make sure that you haven't got too much on your brush here, so just get rid of the excess. And what you're looking to do is paint this onto areas of the skin that are particularly tortured and damaged. So I'm looking at things like all the folds and all the open wounds and the sores and that kind of thing. And all you need to do is just start painting this on roughly towards the recesses I'm doing around here, around this part of the arm. But you don't have to be too focused with it. You can see I'm being quite free with how I apply it. Then once you put some on, just get rid of the excess mix off your brush. Then just use the wet shade on here just to bring it into the rest of the flesh, just like that. So I'm going to go around all the skin now, just adding this effect on and gradually building up this bruise. So now that coat is dry, you can see the effect's quite subtle, but this is perfect because it means that, I'm in control of how strong the effect's going to be. Because now if I add another coat of the same mix of Druki Violet and Lamia Medium at 1-to-1, you can see where I paint it now, the purple's stronger. So by doing this, you can gradually build up the purple to be as strong as you want. Now that second coat's dry, you can see we've got a really nasty looking bruised effect on its skin. It looks horrible, doesn't it? Now you could of course leave this here, but I want to go a bit further. So what I'm going to do now is paint some Karabug Crimson on mixed with Lamia Medium. So again, it's a one-to-one mix and still using my detail brush. And well, it's the same kind of process really. Just need to make sure you get a good mix together on your palette. And once again, be careful not to contaminate the medium with any colour. So get my mix together. And this, again, I'm going to apply moderately. So I'm just going to make sure I don't have very much of this on my brush. I'm going to focus this on all the areas that I want to look more sore. So I'm going to be putting this around all the open wounds, like around his belly, and all the pustules too. And, well, like before, you can just add one coat of this if you want to, but if you want the colour to be a bit stronger, just add another coat. Now the Karabug Crimson is dry, and you can see we've got a really cool effect. I did two coats in the end, focused more around the belly, but, well, it looks absolutely horrible, doesn't it? It looks really painful. Perfect for what a Nurgle model needs. Now, the next thing I'm going to paint are all the open wounds, and for this, I'm going to be using Blood for the Blood God, but you could use Nurgle's Rot as well if you wanted to, and mix the two colours, or just use Nurgle's Rot on its own. But whichever you decide to go for, use your palette to get the paint under control, so you don't need very much in your brush. Don't thin it down with any water, because if you do, you'll start losing that shine. So, use your fine detail brush, just get to a nice point. And what you're looking to do is paint this into all the open wounds. So I'm going to be doing his intestines just down here to start out with, which you can see already have some colour on them from when we initially base coated all the skin. But you just paint this on, you see, and you get a really shiny, horrible, bloody effect. And so you just need to paint over these areas now. And of course, if you wanted to, you could even have some trickling down the front of his body too. And there we go, that's all the open wounds done. So now there's just one more effect that I'm going to do, and that's all the massive boils that are just full of pus. Now, for this, you're going to need three colours. I'm going to start out with XV88 as a base coat, then I'm going to layer over them using Baylor Brown, and finally do a highlight using a Shabti Bone. And for all these colours, I will be using a fine detail brush, because you need to keep as much control over your paint as possible here. So first of all, with XV88, just get the paint ready on your palette, and you don't need too much on your brush, just get that nice fine tip to keep control of it. And what you're looking to do is just paint the boils with this for the base coat. Now, for ones like this, where I've already put some blood on there, I'm just going to be painting basically a circle towards the middle of them. So, just like that, I just want some of that blood still showing in the recess around it. But on these ones that are more flat on the skin here, you just, well, again, looking to paint a circle just in the raised area. And having all that red shade around it that we did earlier on, all that purple, that does make it look like that sort of reddening sore around it. The next step is to apply a layer of Baylor Brown. Now this one you want to focus just a little bit more towards the middle of the boil, so you leave just a small amount of that XV88 showing around the edge. So, just like that. You just need to do this on all the boils. And then the last thing to do on the boil is just to add a highlight of a shabty bone. So just paint a small amount of this just in the middle, and there you go. And if you want to make these look extra gross, then well, you could always put a little bit of hard coat gloss varnish over the top of them to give them a really nasty wet shine. So I decided to put some hard coat over the top of all those pustules and spots, and well, now they look absolutely disgusting, don't they? Now there's just one more thing to do on this miniature, and that's to paint the Nurgling that's ripping through his belly. Now for this, for his skin, you're going to need four different colours. We're going to start out with a base coat of Caliban Green, then layer over the top of that using Strachan Green. After that, I'm going to shade all the Nurgling skin using Agrax Earth Shade, and finally highlight it with Nurgling Green. Now for all these steps, well, the early steps, I'm going to be using a detail brush because the detail's quite fine on this guy. But if you're painting an entire Nurgling, you know, one that's not inside someone's belly, then you'll want to use a larger brush for this first stage. So you just need to get your paint ready, and I'm getting a good tip on the brush. And for this first step, I just want to base coat all the little Nurgling for all the skin that I can see. Just being careful not to get any of this green on the flesh around him. The next stage is to layer the Nurgling with Strachan Green. Now you may need to apply more than one coat of this colour to get a smooth, even colour. But also, as you're doing this, just remember to be careful about all those details around the Nurgling. Once the layer's done, the next thing to do is to apply some Agrax Earthshade over all of the Nurgling's skin. And finally, use your fine detail brush to apply a highlight of Nurgling Green on all the raised bits of detail on the miniature. So just some thin green lines, just like I'm doing here. Now once this is done, all that remains to do on this Nurgling is paint his horns and teeth, which I'll do in the same way as the horns on the rest of the armour, and the eyes, which I'll do the same way as I did the boils. Once that's finished, all that is left to do is his base, and then the model will be complete. So there we go. With the Nurgling done and the base finished, the model is now complete. And as you can see, these miniatures absolutely ooze character, so that means painting them is loads of fun. Now throughout this tutorial I've used a technique where I've diluted my shades with Lamia Medium, and when you do this it is important that you use Lamia Medium for it. If you use water to dilute a shade that much then it will dry patchy and won't look so good, but if you use Lamia Medium it'll dry smooth and you'll find that doing that blend is actually pretty easy to achieve. Now also when you are doing this technique remember to keep the coats of paint thin, that way you'll stay in control of them. You can always add more colour if you want to build up the effect, but it's much harder to take those coats away. Now finally, I know I say this an awful lot, but just try and be as neat as you possibly can. The neater you are, the better the final result's going to be. Now this video has been loads of fun to make, and I really hope you guys have had loads of fun watching it, so I'll see you next time.